Every time I come out to the garden, the turkey and the chickens come running out. They think it's breakfast time. I just fed them breakfast, but every minute of the day is breakfast time for those birds because they just eat and eat and eat and eat and eat. And, I need a camera crew. Oh, this is so cool. There are these birds. They're smaller than a sparrow. I don't want to scare it. It's on my fence to my garden. I wish I had a camera crew so they could turn the camera while I talk. But I'll just describe it as I see it, okay? That's the best I can do right now. There are these little birds that live on this property here. It's like an oasis out in the middle of farmland because there's no trees, you know, out here. There's just nothing but cornfields and soybeans. There's a parent. And so the birds tend to congregate to these little oasis of these oasis of trees. And I got all different kinds of birds. I have bluebirds, blue jays, robins, sparrows, blackbirds, you know, everything. But there are these little tiny birds and they're smaller than sparrows. Yeah, sparrows are a common little brown bird here in the United States. They're smaller than sparrows and they're like little punk rock sparrows. They got this little tuft of feathers up on top of their head. But they are the tiniest little birds, about as big as a hummingbird. And they build nests up in the trees or in the grass. And I actually found a nest in the grass. I almost mowed the darn things over, but I found them and didn't mow them. But they come out to the garden and they make little chirping sounds. And then they jump down and they eat all the grasshoppers. That's actually what's helping me with these grasshoppers. And there's a couple that built their nest in this light on my property. A lot of farms, you may notice, have a light pole out in the middle of their yard, you know, by their house, and there's a street light out there. And this comes on at dusk and goes off at dawn. I have mine turned off because I don't want to use that electricity because it's a mercury vapor or something like that. I have a LED light on my house, and that uses less energy, and I can control when that comes on. Plus, mine was like a disco light. It would go on and go, and it was defective. So I had the power company turn it off. But anyway, what I'm getting at is inside there, where the bulb screws in, is a ledge, and that's where these birds made their nest. So these little itty-bitty birds are always going in, out, in, out. And they come over here to my garden, and they're just pigging out. They just grab a grasshopper and take off. So I'm feeding the world with my garden. I'm feeding myself, I'm feeding my chickens, I'm feeding all the birds that like grasshoppers. So I'm perfectly happy with that. But the little baby, they just left the nest today. Yeah, and I could tell it was a baby because it was flying really hard and it barely got up to the top and it has no tail. You know, like when baby birds first take off, they really don't have much of a tail, so they don't have a rudder. They're just flying like a golf ball with wings. And it just landed over here right next to you. And I wish I could have turned the camera, but no. Eventually, I'm gonna have a camera crew, but right now it's just you and me out here at the garden. But that was really something neat. And by the way, my, I'll talk about the cabbage stuff, the whatever that stuff is later, but I want to show you this for right now. You identified this. Thank you so much. I had no idea what this was. I thought maybe I planted it. And you identified it in the comment section on YouTube and also my friends on Facebook. You identified this weird big leaf beauty as what's called velvet leaf. And it, boy, that's appropriately named because this leaf, it's soft. It feels like velvet. Yeah, it's a beauty. And it turns out that this has a history. And I learned from you, which I think is great, that this was something that was grown for fiber here in the United States. It was brought over from across the sea, brought to the United States, grown as fiber. It didn't work out that well, so they abandoned it. And of course, that's what happens. It becomes a nuisance plant once you abandon it. It's kind of like marijuana, you know. They brought this over around here and they wanted to grow for fiber. Turns out that didn't work out right, so they just abandoned it and then it just goes nuts now, and now they call it a weed. Really kind of sad, you know. It's kind of like throwing away your children. You bring... Hi! I speak fluent turkey. Yeah, I do. Yeah, the turkey's over there waiting for me to bring grasshoppers. I always, when I come out here, I go walking by the chicken coop and I kick the tall grass around there, and grasshoppers fly in and they get their morning grasshopper. So anyway, this thing is called velvet leaf or mallow. And it's considered an invasive species and it's taken over all over the place because apparently it grows so well. Well, apparently it grows really well in the garden. And it's putting out the neatest seed pods like you would not believe. You know, I'm going to start saving these seeds. And I know it's invasive and the farmers don't like it. But you know what? They brought it over. It's on my property. I'll do what I want with it now. If you guys didn't like it, maybe you should have eradicated it when you had the chance. Now that it's here, it's not going anywhere. I'm not the one causing the problem. I'm just taking advantage of the problem that was caused a long, long time ago before I was born. And I think it's a beauty because the flowers are edible. They're nutritious. The leaves are edible, and somebody actually said that they used to wipe their butts with this, you know, like natural toilet paper. Kind of cool, but the leaves are edible. The seeds, if you eat them when they're not ripe, they're like sunflower seeds. And back in the old days, that's what the kids used to do, you know, before they had MTV and video games and 7-Elevens. They used to actually eat the seeds, and they're nutritious, like sunflower seeds, and they taste good before they get ripe. And they're good for you. So this is, and the stem can be used for fiber. Not that I'm going to make my own shirts, but I thought it was pretty cool. So thank you everybody for identifying this. And let's go over to the cauliflower looking things, because yeah, there's been a lot of changes in just the last few days. Keeping the world safe for democracy. Thank you, Tiny R. Yeah. You're doing good. I was on my way over to the cauliflowers, and of course I'm going to stop here. I was out here earlier this morning, and that's the whole reason I filmed this episode, is because I'm out here picking pea pods, because for dinner tonight I'm having beef with pea pods. And so I'm thawing out the beef, and I come out here to get the pea pods, because yesterday I'm out here at the garden, and I'm redoing this bamboo thing, because I thought I outsmarted Mother Nature. You can never outsmart Mother Nature. I have this bamboo thing because the wind always comes up this hill, and it's blowing the peas over here, and I can't even get through anymore, and I'm like, ah, crap. So I put up this bamboo to keep them from falling over so they don't snap. Well, Mother Nature turns around and goes, ah, ha, 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 here comes the wind from the north. And so it blew it all over that way. I'm like, ah, crap, really? I don't have time for this. But then I realized, yeah, I do. I'm unemployed. So I took another piece of bamboo. I got a whole stock of this stuff. It's wonderful. I got it dirt cheap. And I put it on the other side and stood them up. But what I realized is, you don't notice you have so many peas. I mean, you're growing peas and you got all these flowers. And then one day you go, oh, crap, really? I got that many pea pods? And yeah, you better pick those things quick. So I thought, oh, I'll do that tomorrow. You know, it was hot yesterday. It was humid. Life sucked. And I thought, no, I'm going to do it tomorrow, because it's going to be in the high 70s tomorrow with no humidity. So beautiful day today. And I come out today, and like I said, never mess with Mother Nature, because I come out today and all these peas are getting fat. You know, they were thin as paper yesterday, and I had enough to feed an army. You all could have come over and we would have had beef pea pods, or maybe if you're vegan, you know, maybe just pea pods. But we could have all had pea pods. That, with just a handful of peas, I got enough to feed an army here. And I thought, oh crap, well, I'll pick them tomorrow. Well, today, most of them are fat, and I don't like them once they start getting fat. I mean, they're just not as good for me. I like to get them when they're real young and small and thin, like the little baby ones. Oh, they just melt in your mouth. But they get all tough when they get older. So yeah, you really gotta eat these things when they're thin. So anyway, I'm out picking these things. I'm like, oh wow, that ought to make a good episode. I'll show you what not to do. I'm the gardening crashiest dummy of the decade. You cannot let your peas go crazy. So with a handful of peas I planted here that somebody gave me, thank you, I got so many pea pods. Even the ones that I picked, I had managed to get enough for dinner tonight and then some. I filled up on pea pods. I got enough for dinner, and I got enough left over for all my seeds for the next year or two. And they're still flowering. This thing's still going nuts. It's going crazy. And but anyway, there's a tip for you. When you're picking pea pods, pick the heck out of those things, because they will get fat overnight and you'll regret it. And also, the more you pick, the more you get. Same thing as beans. I picked beans yesterday in the heat, and there's more beans now too. I got more green beans than I can shake a stick at. Green onions are going good too. I picked some green onions, so I'm gonna have beef, pea pods, green onions, a pinch of cilantro, and that's going to be my dinner. My pea pods are always my breakfast. This is what I have every day for breakfast. Not that I'm a vegetarian or anything. It's just that I'm out here and they're good, and I figure, why not? And I never eat breakfast. I've never been a breakfast person. So this actually is really good, because, you know, when you're sipping coffee, it can kind of wreck your gut. So I come out here and I eat a stomach full of pea pods, and I'm good for the day. Oh, anyway. Ooh, that's kind of tough. I was just going to eat this and... No! Okay, well, anyway, I want to show you what's going on with cauliflower. I think that's cauliflower growing over there. It was just a couple days ago I filmed it, and it was big and beautiful. It's amazing what just a couple days can do. Take a look at this. Ooh. Yeah, it's looking even worse. But I filmed this, and of course, somebody said, there's no way that stuff is waist high. Cauliflower doesn't get waist high. Really? Okay, well, let's find out if cauliflower gets waist high. Hooray, step inside the cauliflower. All right, here's my waist, here's my cauliflower. waist high, there. Argument solved. But I didn't come out here to show you the size of the cauliflower. I came out here to show you another thing that happened in my garden. Let's get in real close because you got to see this. These leaves were looking so big and beautiful, and there I was patting myself on my back. You know, you cannot be arrogant when it comes to Mother Nature and your garden, because the second you step out of line, she slaps you back into line. She will tell you when you're being stupid. Anyway, so I'm showing off my cauliflower. Wow, these are really huge. What are they? I think they're cauliflower. Well, anyway, the very next day I come out, and the day after that too, I notice, look at all these holes. Well, I did have some holes in my cauliflower from the grasshopper damage back when they were young. Well, they outgrew that. There was only a few holes, but there was a lot of holes out here. It happened almost overnight. And people that have grown cabbage, cauliflower, broccoli, kale, things like that, you know what's going on. Oh, bug just hit me. You know what's going on. You come out and you're like, what happened? It looked like somebody took a shotgun to this. Let's zoom in. I'm going to show you what's going on with this thing, because I have problems with my garden every bit as much as you do. And I want to show you this. This is something that you normally don't see because they hide really, really well. And they do hide really... Brought to you by I Can't Shut Up. Okay, that really worked out well. Okay, anyway, back to what we're going to do here. You need to look really close, and these things actually do move kind of quick. You don't see anything here, right? You're wondering, like, what's causing these holes? It could be slugs or snails, because they tend to eat off of the center of the leaves. And in the morning is when you want to look for slugs and snails, because they go away when the heat of the sun comes out, because it dries off the leaves, and they like to be on the plants when it's moist in the middle of the night. But I flip these leaves over. This is what you'll see. And what they'll do is they'll hide along the vein, and that's how they keep from getting eaten. They'll either hide on the back or sometimes on the front. And the way that you'll know you'll have these worms, these little caterpillars, they're called cabbage worms. You'll normally see these little tiny dark green poops. That's their poop. Yeah, it's really kind of gross. God forbid they should get off your plant to take a dump. I call them inchworms. I don't know if that's what they are. But anyway, let me grab one here and stand up so the camera doesn't jerk around quite so much. They don't like being picked up. Yep, I have millions of these things. I went from having none to having uncounted amounts of these. I flipped the leaves over yesterday, and I wish I would have had the camera with me. I need a GoPro camera on my head at all times. That way I can film what I see, because I see things and I go running for the camera the next day and it isn't here the next day. So anyway, yeah. So I got a big old container of these and took them out to the chickens. Turns out chickens like these things. I call them inchworms. They're probably not inchworms, but yep, these will decimate your coal crops. And of course, I have so many of them here, I could spray them with pyrethrin, or I could dust the leaves with diatomaceous earth, which is that powdered diatoms. It's a powder that you dust your plants with in any... Hold on a second. Hey, Rascal. Rascal, no. Sorry, baby. I got to talk here. All right. You can dust your leaves with diatomaceous earth. And what that stuff is it's a powder that you get in a bag. It's made from fossilized diatoms, which are these really tiny sea creatures. And it's like, the best I could describe it is powdered shards of like glass. And munching creatures will eat it. And it will get inside and chew them up. And also for snails and slugs, they go over it. It's like going over an obstacle course of shredded glass, and it will kill them. But see, here's one that's hiding out. See, right there. Yeah, they're pretty smart. They're not stupid. And you know, you don't think of insects as having intelligence, but you know what? Here, let me put this guy back. Don't fall. Come on, grab it. Oh, sad face. Well, he just took a tumble. But you think of these critters as being not too bright. Well, you know what? Insects have been around longer than we have. They know what they're doing. This insect evolved to be the same color as the food it's eating, to be able to hide out, to keep from being eaten, because birds love these things. They will land on your stuff and eat these. But you can spray them with pyrethrin, which is wonderful, or you can sprinkle diatomaceous earth on them, and that'll help kill them too. But you know what? I'm not going to do that. I don't really need my cauliflower that much, and I know this is probably not going to settle well with folks, but I don't need my my cauliflower that much, and I have the birds, and I have so much food in my garden anyway. I'm going to let them go. I know, that's just killing you. I'm going to let them go, and I'm going to pick them every day and give them to my birds for a treat. Yeah, and maybe next year if I'm going to be growing this kind of stuff, I'll have a problem and I'll deal with it then, but that's just my method. I don't recommend this for anybody else. I recommend you pluck them off. That's the best bet. Pluck them off and throw them away. Oh, another one. Oh, that's really cute. That's a little tiny one. Look at the little baby. Because, you know, if you're going to pluck them off, you better have a whole day. Because there's a lot of them out here, and they are itty-bitty. Don't know where they come from, but itty-bitty tiny things, and they will go nuts. And I don't want to fight with my garden, so I figured, what the heck. It's chicken food. And so I'm sacrificing my cauliflower for the chickens. And if I get some cauliflower out of it, that's great. And if I don't, no big deal. This will be great for the compost pile, won't it? Hey. Yeah, we don't like it, huh? Yeah. Stay off our property. Oh, he loves it. And you know, I really do enjoy the fact that I can just let this little crackhead out here and bark all he wants, and no neighbors are going to complain at all. Because I went to go visit my mom and my sister over in Nebraska a couple weeks ago, and I was planting a couple tomato plants for my mom, and Rascal's running around outside, and he's barking and having a good time, and a neighbor about a half a block away down the alley came out of the house. She yelled out, "Shut up!" as loud as she could, and I thought, wow, I forgot, you know, that it irritates people when he barks. And I understand that. It will irritate people. I wouldn't want somebody's dog barking and messing with me. But out here, he can do it all he wants. Normally, if I, you know, lived in a neighborhood, and also back where I used to live, I had to tell him to stop doing that. But out here, I encourage it, you know, because this is what he wants to do. He wants to come out here, and he wants to sniff, and he wants to run around. Hey, come here. He wants to sniff and run around and bark and have a good time, and that's exactly what he can do. So what's going on? Yeah, want to say goodbye to everybody? I'm gonna go walk around out at the edge of the yard, and he's gonna probably go out with me and bark at stuff. Thanks for joining me in the garden. I really do appreciate it. I had a great time. Oh, we'll talk to you next time. Bye. Grr. Yeah. Let's go.